Without further delay, I'm really excited to be part of this GRE online workshop. It's a four-day workshop. I'll just give you a background about how we're planning this. Every day, starting today, we are going to have a session on various topics. So today's session, we are going to focus on masters, how you should go about planning your entire masters, what are the kind of schools you should apply, how should you go about choosing the schools, and how should you go about applying, how to write SOPs and things like that. So it's going to be a session which is a very important part of your entire GRE journey or your master's journey rather. It's exciting to see so many of you on a nice Tuesday morning. I'm here in Bangalore. I'm not sure, where all you guys are joining from. The weather is awesome and nice and pleasant. Maybe you can just type in the city you're joining from. That will be exciting to see where all, people are joining from. Cool. So I have people from Bangalore, Delhi, Chennai, Hyderabad. Awesome. Gwalior, Nasik. Superb. Great. So let's start Monday also. Great. Awesome. So let's start our session. We'll start with some ground rules. Okay. I just want to make sure that if you have any questions, you can just type on the Q&A window or on the chat window. I would like to take up all the questions in the end, unless it's very relevant to the topic that we are talking about. Just make sure you can just put in your questions on the chat window or on the Q&A window, where I'll be completely monitoring the questions so that I can help you answer those questions too. Cool? Cool. So why this session is important, I'm sure you all know that this is the time where you should start thinking about how you should go about, focusing on your application for masters. I have been mentoring thousands of students across the globe focusing on masters and MBA programs. What I realize is all of them jump into this test prep. They start preparing for their GRE or they start preparing for other tests. They are pretty much lost in terms of planning out that after GRE, then what, right? In fact, when you take your GRE also, I hope you know that you have to put in at least 4 school names over there. So the scores go for free to those 4 schools. So it's very important that you understand the entire, what is important for you to take care in the entire journey. And most importantly, why are you even studying for your GRE, right? Because this is the most important aspect of it. GRE is just phase 1. Right. So here are some things that we are going to focus on: timelines, fall versus spring. We are going to focus on how to select universities. We are going to focus on what do ADCOMs actually look for. So ADCOMs means the admission committee, the people who are there sitting and providing you an admit. And finally, the application checklist. What should you be focusing on in terms of your applications and, how you should go about doing that. Right. Cool. Just a little bit of myself. I'm Shreekala. I'm the co-founder as well as the chief COO at Crackable. I worked in the IT industry for over a decade, mentored thousands of students in the master's and MBA journey. I'm also the fellow of ISB's Goldman Sachs Women Entrepreneur Program. I'm a mentor to a lot of women entrepreneurs. I love mentoring, entrepreneurs who want to understand how to go about and, build their businesses. I'm also part of Cherry Blair Foundation of Women Entrepreneurs. So that's a quick about me. Just a little bit about Crackable. So we mentors thousands of students across GMAT and for GMAT and GRE, and obviously helping them with their masters and MBA abroad. You can go through a lot of free resources. It's on our website. There is online.crackable.com/GRE. There is an online GRE course that you can explore. There are some trial videos to see if it's a fitment to what exactly you are looking for. A lot of free resources, ebooks on our website. Great for vocabulary, understanding GRE, the verbal section or the quant section, understanding about a lot of top schools. Answers to the official guide are there on our YouTube channel. You can actually, when you're preparing, if you're stuck at any question, you can go through these solutions. It's a great help to a lot of people who are actually preparing for their GRE. Awesome flashcards. So what we've done is we actually got a cartoonist to create this for us. This is a set of 500 flashcards, all highly frequent words on the GRE. The idea is to learn three mnemonics and not memorizing. So this is also something that you can find on our website, or you also have the, you know, the whole packet available on Amazon. So you can buy it from there too. Cool. Cool. So, and obviously, you know, a lot of strategies and blogs that you can go through about funding and, you know, top schools and things like that. Cool. So let's get on to the application timeline. So we are at July right now. So how many of you are, let me just look at the poll. Okay. Is there a poll? Okay. There is. So how many of you are actually preparing for your GRE right now? You can just raise your hand so that I can just understand how many of you are preparing right now. Awesome. I have around, okay, more than half of you are preparing. How many of you have already taken your GRE? Okay. Around a couple, around 5-6 people of, okay, cool. Cool. So for all those people who are still preparing, or, you know, in their plan for preparation, this is how your timeline should look at. Obviously, while you take you're preparing for your GRE, parallelly, you should research on the universities that you're looking at. We will, you know, put in some light on how you should select those universities. Once you're done with selection of universities and you have taken your GRE, you have to focus on writing your SOPs, your recommendation, your transcript. Once you submit your application is when you actually focus on your visa, you focus on your finances, loans, and things like that. So those are the things you have to focus on while you go ahead with the whole plan. We'll focus on specific questions, Surbhi. What I will do is I will just go through my flow. I just want to make sure we go through all the points that is important as part of your journey, right? So I just want to go step by step. Raghav, if you're just a beginner, you don't know about GRE, we'll talk about it in a while, right? So let's focus on the master's application part, which is what we are going to focus on. What we can do is we can send you some stuff that, you know, which can help you understand more about the GRE aspect of it, right? Cool. So next step. So all of you know about spring and fall intake. You might have heard, okay, when does spring start? When does fall start, right? So very important aspect over here. So what happens is when you're looking at applying, especially for master's program, there are two intakes. One is the spring intake, which starts in January, and the fall intake, which starts in September every year. Which means if you're looking at applying for 2019, right? So this is 2018 now, we are at July 2018. And if you're looking at applying for September 2019 intake, it's important that you start preparing right now, which is you are in July. You start preparing for your GRE right now. Maybe around, you take around 2 to 3 months focusing on your GRE preparation. By October, yeah, by September is September, October is when, you know, you will start seeing a lot of deadlines are, we'll talk about the deadlines part also. October to December is when a lot of deadlines for a lot of top schools are there, which is for the fall intake, right? Spring intake is slightly later, since it's January 2020 is what you're looking at, because most of the deadlines for January 2019 are almost over. They come through June, from May to June or April to June, which is for January 2019, all the deadlines are over. So if you're looking at January 2020, your deadline will start in April 2019 and it will be somewhere around till July, August. If you're looking at September 2019, your deadlines will start this year in October. Got it? Right? So we just have to focus on making sure we understand the timelines very well, and we make sure that, you know, you go through the entire preparation. A quick brief about what, you know, for some people who don't understand anything about GRE. So GRE is a test you take to apply to masters abroad. There are two sections, the verbal and the quant section. Verbal is divided into sentence equivalence, test completion. There's reading comprehension. There's vocabulary, which is part of sentence equivalence and test completion, and critical reasoning. In math, you have, algebra, arithmetic, geometry. The total score is out of 340, divided 170 for verbal and 170 for quant, right? So that's a brief about the GRE. Coming back to the fall and spring intake, right? What is the difference between fall and spring intakes? A lot of people ask me this question and they say, okay, ma'am, what is the best intake to apply for, right? So here is a small table that I've kind of created to make sure that you understand the difference between a fall and a spring intake, right? So obviously fall has larger classes. Relatively, spring intake have smaller classes. More courses are offered. So say, for example, there are close to 3,000 universities in US only. And if you add Asian schools, or if you add Australia or Canada or New Zealand or, you know, Singapore, there are a lot more colleges that apply master's program, right? Now, what happens is, especially for fall intake, all colleges will have intakes in fall, which means most courses are, offered in the fall intake. Whereas spring intake, not all colleges offer spring intake. So say, for example, just to give you an example, that you are eyeing for a specific course in computer science, which focuses on artificial intelligence, right? In one specific university, let me give you an example, say Purdue, right? Now, I'm not saying necessarily Purdue doesn't have it. I'm just giving you this example, right? Now, Purdue has this course in Masters in Computer Science. This focuses on, say, cybersecurity or artificial intelligence. Right? It might not offer the same program for the spring intake, but it does have it for the fall intake, right? Acceptance rates, which is the chances that you get an admit, are much, much higher in fall compared to spring. So you really need to have great grades to, you know, get that admit in the spring intake, because the class size is also smaller, right? Assistantship, which is the kind of scholarships, or there are different kind of assistantship that we get. I'll be talking about slightly more in detail later, but assistantships are provided more in fall compared to in spring. And obviously you have an option to finish the course faster in fall, and you can take internships and things like that compared to the spring intake. Cool. So that's pretty much the difference between the fall and spring intake. For all of you who are attending the webinar today, you are perfectly in time for the fall intake in September 2019. If you start your preparation now, or if you take your GRE anytime before October, or October is the best timeline to take, because by then you will have 1 month to focus on your applications, so that by December, the deadline part, you are able to, apply to these schools, right? So if you're starting now, or if you start preparation now, it's a perfect time for you to go ahead and start preparing for your GRE, right? So I think all of you over here, if you've not started your preparation yet, I think it's a good time for you to do so, right? Cool. Let's get to the next most important part. Lot of people have this question, right? How do I select schools, right? So what happens is, most of the people select school based on a couple of things. Okay, I want to go apply to this particular school because my friend has gone there, or my relatives are in and around that area, or my colleagues or my boss has studied from that school, or anything of that sort, right? So all our decisions are completely based on what others say. What I believe, it's important that you all have to focus on what is good for you, right? So I want all of you to do this research, and I'll tell you how to go about with this research also. What I want you to do is, you should look at each and every school in these four categories, right? First is obviously specialization. You should focus on what is the chance of admit. We'll go on each and every topic in detail. Third is geography. Okay, is this the geography you want to go to? And fourth is the budget. Very important part, right? Obviously, very important part, right? Now tell me, how many of you, you can just raise your hand, how many of you are going to take a loan or pay for yourself or pay the loan yourself when you do your master's? Awesome, right? So lot of you, I think more people are, people who are going to pay it for themselves, and parents are not really going to pay for you, which is a good thing, which means it's very important that all of you are very cautious about spending your own money, because now it's you who's going to pay, right? Most of us, when we did our graduation or undergrads, it's always our parents who have paid for our, education. But now when you're looking at a master's and you're looking at doing a master's abroad, and since you are going to pay from your own pocket, it's very important that you are part of this entire research, and just don't depend on anyone telling you that this school is good. I want you to make sure that this school is good for you, right? So just make sure you do that research in terms of, and make sure you create an Excel sheet with these four columns: specialization, chances of admission, budget, and geography. And then let's go step by step to figuring out, okay, which works for you and how you should go about doing it, right? Now, let's say specialization, right? So first, obviously, check if the department of your field of specialization exists. Very important, right? So you need to make sure that is there. Look at the various elective offered, right? Now, like I said, I spoke about computer science and I said about cybersecurity or artificial intelligence or data analytics or data science, right? Nowadays, data science and business analytics are all doing great, you know, in terms of the chances of getting a job or the kind of exposure people are getting in terms of these particular electives, right? So it's doing really well. So maybe you want to look at, you know, what are the electives offered? What are the allied master's programs that exist? So you also want to make sure that under this, say, for example, there is an MSBA program, which is a master's in business analytics, which again comes under the computer science umbrella, right? Or you're looking at, you know, MS in cybersecurity, or you're looking at, say, biomedical, or you're looking at some specialization in biomedical, right? Some people are looking at, you know, something related to forensic, right? So it could be anything. So you want to make sure that what are the kind of master's programs are there, which are the you know, allied electives that are available. Sorry about that, right? So you want to make sure all of you can hear me now. I'm sorry, I think there was a problem. Just type in yes if you can, or raise your hand, that would be great. Cool, okay, I'll continue. Thank you so much, guys. Cool. So fourth is the, you know, you need to make sure you understand the background of the faculty and the PhD programs. Make sure you go through the website. You try to go through what are the faculty, who are the faculties, what are their backgrounds, what are the PhD programs available. Very, very important, right? So you want to make sure you go through all this understanding of the specialization to help you go through selecting the right school of your choice, right? So make sure that is done. So how do I choose the, you know, right program for myself, right? All of you might be asking, right? Now, our top specializations, again, this is based on my, experience working with students across geographies and people with different kind of backgrounds. These are the top specializations that I have seen and I have worked with. People who are from biomedical or bioengineering background, chemical, civil, computer science, electronic, electrical or communications, environmental and environmental health, and mechanical, right? So these are the top programs that I have seen Indians actually apply for. So these are the kind of, if you are in any of these, or, you know, if you're looking at the right kind of program or whatever specialization you are looking at, you want to make sure you look at the schools around that. Let me just give you an example about, say, biomedical, right? Now, what I have done is I've created this table in two parts, right? So if you look at the left-hand side, these are all top programs, which is the top, I would say, 10 programs. This is the top 1 to top 10 ranking programs for biomedical, right? On the right-hand side, now, what happens, especially if you're looking at, you're looking at, say, biomedical, right? What we actually have to do is, one is you look at the rankings. One is you also look at, okay, what are the kind of, specializations, or like I said, you know, faculty, or what are the kind of research work that is happening in that college. What I've done in the right-hand side list, like, for example, University of Washington or Boston or Minnesota or Southern California or Maryland or Ohio State or Rutgers, these might not be in the top 10. These might be in the top 20, 30, right? So what I've done is I've created this list. From this list, we will go through, okay, what is the top 5 for you, or what is the top 10 for you, right? Madhura, very good question. Obviously, there are thousands of universities. How do you choose at least 10? Like I said, divide it into 4 parts. Look at specialization, look at budget, look at geography, and which is the 4th? Chances of admission, right? Because all these 4 things are very important when you're looking at the kind of schools you want to apply for, right? Cool. Here, another example, you know, most of the people, so how many of you are here from the computer science background? If you could just raise your hand. Great. So I see a lot of you from computer science background, right? So cool. So I've created this list for people from the computer science background. Again, these are just examples. Obviously, you know, we have lists from each and every specialization that you're looking at. If you're interested, maybe you can reach out to us later. And we would definitely love to help you out throughout the process, right? So if you look at the top 10, 11 here, I've put down the top 11 here. If you look at the right, again, they might not be the top 10, but you know, these are again very good schools, right? Now, especially when you're looking at US, what also happens is most of these schools are, you know, so US is, you have state schools, state universities, and you have private universities, right? Now, what happens is when you're looking at, say, Caltech, right? Caltech is one of the best. If you look at top 9, this is rank number 9, right? Caltech is famous for technology. It's right in the, you know, West Coast, very close to Silicon Valley, very close to a lot of startups and a lot of big companies which are there. It is also one of the cheapest because obviously, as being a state university, it also gets a lot of funds from the governments and grants. So it's easier for, you know, it's easier. It will cost you around $34,000 or something for 2 years, right? Now, again, this also makes it one of the most sought after and one of the most competitive schools that you can apply for, right? Now, which means that obviously you have to really have a very high score on the GRE, have very good credentials in your profile to make sure you apply to a school like this, right? So various aspects of, you know, how you should evaluate your chances of admission. So you should make sure that you look at all the kind of schools and then plan out, you know, what are the kind of schools you want to apply to, right? So this is one example of the top computer science programs. Next is geography, right? Now, again, very important factor, like I said, you know, public universities and private universities. You're looking at public University of Michigan, private is maybe you look at Carnegie Mellon, right? That is private, right? If you're looking at big city versus small city, MIT versus a small town, say Virginia Tech, right? Cheaper to live over there. So you also want to look at, when I say chances of admission could also be based on acceptance rate. It could also be based on your GRE score. It could be also be based on your profile. So we'll talk a little bit more about what takes you, you know, when I say profile, what do you mean by profile, right? I'll talk about it in a little while, right? And then obviously career opportunities, technology, West Coast, you know, say for example, if you're looking at MS in finance, right? Maybe you want to be slightly more closer to New York or somewhere in the East Coast because there is when most of the financial institutions are there, right? If you're looking, say, a career opportunity in healthcare, John Hopkins is one of the best in healthcare. Boston University, again, healthcare, right? So you also want to look at, okay, geography-wise, what are the kind of schools you are looking at? What is also important is when you're looking at the schools, say, you know, I had students who said, you know, I want to choose, say, East Coast only because my sister stays in Virginia and, you know, I think I will save on the lodging cost because, you know, I want to stay closer to that her, right? Which could be a good option, right? That could be something you want to choose your geography for. Or say you're very clear that you don't want to apply to US, you want to apply to only, say, Asian schools, you want to only apply to Singapore or you only want to apply to, say, you know, other colleges, right? So other countries, right? So that could also be one criteria in terms of the geography, right? So I'm just taking US over here because most of the applicants are looking at US as one geography. So I just picked up that as an example. Obviously, you know, there are other schools you're looking at, you know, masters in UK or Europe or, you know, Canada or, you know, any other country for that matter, right? So obviously, the method of how you apply to these, you know, places changes. It doesn't follow the same process as how US does. Some countries only accept, but they don't even accept GRE scores. Again, then they might not be the top schools, right? So you want to make sure you apply to schools where it is not very easy to get into, because the moment it is easy for you to get into, it will be easier for a lot more people, right? And then you don't want to go and go, you know, see, most important when you're looking at a foreign education is you are looking at international exposure. One part is, yes, you want to work or you want to study in world-class infrastructure and great professors and great faculties. You also want to make sure that you are among those kind of peers who give you competition, right? You don't want to be a rock star over there, right? You want to strive to be a rock star over there. So it's important that when you're looking at applying to a top school or one of the best schools in the world, and you're looking at striving to push in really high in terms of your GRE scores also, you want to make sure you select the schools of your choice properly. You also want to make sure that you apply to schools where there is some kind of standard in the kind of students who are joining the school and things like that. However, it's not wrong to apply to schools which are slightly lower ranking schools, because everyone has their own level of aspiration. It's perfectly fine. The whole idea is we just have to make sure you understand what you actually require so that we can plan it accordingly for you, right? So that's how you should plan it out. Finally, the chances of admission, the third point, which is the chances of admission. So here's like a good mix that I normally tell students. What you should focus on is you should have two stretch, two reach, and two safe schools. Right now, say for example, the average of the GRE, say, let me pick up, say, Georgia Tech, right? Georgia Tech average says 323 or something like that, right? Now, say for example, you have a 320 plus, then obviously Georgia Tech is a safe bet for you. If you have a 310 to 315, then it might be like a reach school for you. If you have something less than 300, then it might be a really stretch to apply to a school like Georgia Tech, right? So you want to make sure that, you know, even based on GRE, you understand the chances of admission of the kind of school you're applying to based on the published average or GRE average in that particular school, right? So you want to be in that, range. Recommended mix is at least, you know, while you're applying for the first round, which is somewhere in December, you at least apply to six schools. Four schools anyway, for free, you can send your scores to. So you can apply to two stretch, two reach, and two safe schools, right? So that should be a recommended mix in terms of the kind of schools you should, send your scores to, right? Clear so far? Just raise your hand. That should be good for me to understand. Cool. Awesome. Great. Cool. So we'll go to the next part, right? So very, very important part. Count your money, right? Budget is a very important part when you plan your master's, not only for you, for your parents or anyone who's going to pull in money for this particular, program that you're looking at, which you're aspiring to join, right? Lot of people ask me, okay, how do I, make sure that what are the kind of scholarships available, right? Especially when you're coming to masters, there are various kind of scholarships available, right? Now, there is one very important factor that you need to understand when it comes to your GRE score, right? Lot of people ask me, I have a lower GRE score, can I get a scholarship, right? Now, I'll tell you one thing. Be very clear on this factor, very clear on this thought process, right? A scholarship is given to only those people whom the school wants. It means they should want you to be as part of the class. They want to lure you by giving you a scholarship so that you join them. Nobody gives you money to make you rich. Nobody gives you money because you need it. It's because either you have a great GRE score, two, you have a great profile, they feel that you will be a great asset in terms of the kind of research or the kind of, work experience that you have. So all those things, this is what I call a profile, right? All those things will be important in terms of giving you any kind of scholarship or any kind of assistant. Repeating again, scholarships are given to those whom they want in the class, right? Now, why does GRE score become very important here? Now, what happens is one of the criteria for the schools to be ranked high, right, is the average GRE score of the class, right? Now, what happens is the moment you go with a 330 and say the published average of that particular school is say 320 or a 315, right? The moment you go with a 320 or a 330 or a 325 or something like that, they want to make sure you're part of the class because you being in that class will improve their average. In turn, will improve their ranking, right? So they will definitely want to give you some scholarships so that you can come and join the course, right? Another thing, obviously, especially when you're looking at US, as a on your F1 visa, which is your student visa, you also get 20 hours that you can work over there. You get paid around $8 to $15 per hour. You can work in the campus. You can pay, work as a, say, a lab assistant. You can work as a library assistant. You can work as a parking attendant. You can work as a computer lab assistant, right? So those kind of things are available. So 20 hours you can work. You can work in Pizza Hut. So you can work in any of these, you know, 20 hours you can work part-time. That is one option. Second thing you can get is something called a TA or a GA. TA is a teaching assistantship or a graduate assistantship. What happens is all of these programs, right, they have professors, right? Now, professors have money which has been granted by the government for some kind of research that they have been doing. Now, what they do is they give this some part of money to interns or, say, assistants, you know, or graduate research assistants, which is called the stipend that you get when you are part of their research program, which means you help that process, that professor for a research, and he will give you in turn some kind of stipend, and it ranges from around $800 to $1,200 per month, depending on which school, what kind of project, what kind of professor, you know, it can vary, right? So that is called graduate assistantship. Another thing is called teaching assistantship. Say, for example, in your SOP, you have highlighted that, you know, you have always mentored students, you have made sure you're part of many seminars, you are a subject matter expert in something, or say, you know, at work, you have mentored your new recruits that come to the your team and things like that. What also happens is you are trying to highlight your teaching capability. Now, what happens is teaching assistantship is given to those. So you work with a professor. So say, for example, you help him with creating tests, you know, or checking the tests, or you know, helping create quizzes and things like that, or maybe taking few lectures that the professor takes in lower classes, maybe say a undergrad class, right? So you can go and, you know, you assist the professor in replacing him to take a few classes because he thinks you are a good replacement, you know, you are really good in teaching also. So teaching assistantships are given. This again, you get paid monthly, ranges from $500 to $800, depends on which school, which college and things like that, right? So those kind of options are available. Scholarships, I've already spoken about. Every school has a list of colleges that scholarships that they provide. So you can actually go through the school website and have a look at what are the kind of fellowships or what are the kind of scholarships that they provide. Loans are available. Colleges provide loans. Loans are also available through third-party banks. So obviously you're looking at, say, banks in India like SBI or Axis Bank or HDFC. They have something called Credila, which has a student loan. There are also companies called Prodigy Finance. There are also companies called Empower. So what happens in these companies is they actually sponsor top 100 master's programs, right? So maybe you can, you know, Google for them. And in fact, we will have sometime later a webinar with them too, where they will help you on the kind of finances and the loans that are provided. And obviously living costs, like I said, we are already discussed in the geography factor, right? So if you are living in a very expensive city, obviously the living costs are higher. A lot of colleges also have dorms. So obviously it's cheaper to stay inside rather than staying outside. However, say, for example, if you are in, say, a city of Chicago, or in fact, just yesterday I spoke to a student who is joining ASU. Right, Arizona. So she's joining ASU and she's already got in touch with some Indian club over there, and they've already, you know, they already have got four girls together, and they've already planned which apartment to take in which area, and it's closer to the college and things like that. So all that is already set. She's not even left India, right? So all those things are possible. So there are a lot of things you'll get to know once you get to that point. But yeah, this is like a background of how it works, right? So budget is also very important. Make sure you understand that how much money is required, how much loans you need to take and things like that. So here is a brief on, you know, what is the amount that is required to do a master's in US. So what happens is when you're looking at a master's, it's important that you, to complete a master's, you need to have at least 36 credits, right? Now, 36 credits, there are something called core courses, and there are something called electives that you can take from other specializations also. Right, so core courses are mandatory. There is no option, you have to take. But then there are other courses that you can take from other specialization. But in total, you have to make sure you get those 36 credits, right? So this is how you have to, you know, plan your semester. You have to plan each semester and the kind of credit hours. Each separate elective that you take or each separate credit that you take might be an extra cost for you. So once you get there, you'll understand, okay, how do you manage to make sure that you take the number of electives and how do you take the number of courses to make sure that your final credits required for a master's degree is met, right? This is a great table, again, created to give you an idea about what is an average cost that happens across countries. So if you look at the kind of cost that is required, say in US, right? Again, this is an average. I have not really picked up the higher the school. Say, for example, if you're applying to, say, a Harvard, Wharton, Stanford, MIT kind of program, obviously it's much, much more expensive. And I'm looking at more like an average tuition fees in US being around $33,000, living costs around $24,000. The visa required is F1. If you are in a STEM program, you also get some OPT period. So that is also something that you will get. Australia is 29,000. All is in US dollars, so it's been converted into US dollars. 18,000 in living costs. There is something called 485, which is the student visa that you get. Again, you get to work for 18 months post your graduation. Canada, $25,000. Again, an average. The course should be at least, so Canada, the best thing is you get to work there for 3 years post your, masters. So you really don't need to, worry too much about things like H1 and all, which is what most people worry about in US, right? So Canada, you can actually go ahead and work for 3 years after that. UK, there's something called Tier 2 visas. I think you should go and look at the UK website to understand more about the kind of visas that are available. What I've again understood from students who are right now in UK and done their masters, especially for technical programs, since you're looking at masters in technical programs. In fact, after Brexit, things have got better for them. I have had students who are saying that, they already have 4 offers in hand because most people from Europe are going back to their own country. So there is a good scope for Indian applicants, Asian applicants over there. So it is definitely good for, UK is also something that's looking promising nowadays. But please do make sure you do your own research in terms of the kind of schools you want to apply to. Singapore has something called LTVP, which is a long-term visitor pass, which gives you a one-year renewal in terms of post your graduation. And then it depends on what kind of employer you get to and things like that. Similar for New Zealand, it's around 17,000, 20,000, and you get a 12-month visa, right? So that's how the whole thing is structured. Yes, STEM courses, you get an extension for 1.5 years, which is 18 months, right? So that's how it works for STEM courses. So see, there's one question over here which says, is 1 year UK master's program equivalent to 2 year master's program in US? What I would suggest you should do is you should go through the course curriculum. You should go through what is taught in terms of in 1 year versus 2 year. Because see, it also depends on where you want to work eventually, right? If you're looking at working in UK or if you're looking at working in US, and the chances of job opportunities, obviously US is one of the largest economies of the world. So obviously the job opportunities in US versus UK is much, much higher, right? So in terms of the program, I think you should go through the curriculum to understand what are the kind of, what is better, whether it's UK better or US better. Again, it completely depends on you, on what exactly you are looking at and where you want to, go ahead and apply to or live, right? So cool. So I'll just take a quick list of the kind of questions. Deepak, I really don't have a private public university comparison right now, but I would love to send it to you sometime later. I'll definitely, do that sometime later. Right, so you can just write to us. We would love to help you send that details to. Right, cool. So we are done with understanding what is timeline. We are done with understanding what requires you to get an admit. We are done with understanding how to select the schools. How does the elective thing work? How does credits work? We are done with understanding the cost of a master's across the world, which country, how much it will cost, how's the average, and things like that. We have also understood what are acceptance rates, what are fall intake, spring intake, right? So once you're done with your GRE, then what, right? So most important part is you also need to understand that application is also one very important part of your entire journey, right? Most of the people think that, writing SOPs, what's the big deal? It's just a one-page thing. I can just write it, or I'll just pull out a template from the internet and I'll just copy paste and just send it across. please do not do that, especially if you're looking at applying to top schools. Please put in that effort of writing your own SOP. SOPs are reviewed. It's a very important part of your application. And your application or your admit can be based on how good or bad your SOP is. Because, see, the whole idea is they want to understand your purpose of why you want to actually go through this program, right? So if you go through people who are just going to give you a template and say, give me money and, you know, come back 5 days later, all your five SOPs are ready, please don't go through them. Because if then 100 people will have the same SOP, right? Then you don't want to go and, you know, it's like pure plagiarism. Don't even do that, right? Write your own SOPs. Make sure if you're looking at taking help, Crackable helps. We can help you in terms of writing SOPs and, you know, how to go about, you know, your own SOP. But it's very important that you should apply. You should write your own SOPs. There's a question over here by Subrata which says, what is the difference between STEM and non-STEM? So STEM is science, technology, engineering and mathematics. These are specific programs which can come under this umbrella, and they have an extra OPT period. You get some extra time when it comes to STEM programs to stay on your student visa, right? Post. So what happens, especially in US, I'll just, you know, give a little bit more background on that aspect. Now, what happens is, especially when you're looking at US, when you go to study over there, you go on an F1 visa, right? Which is a student visa. Now, what happens is, once you are done with your F1 visa, once you're finished your program, you get some extra time, which is in 18 months if you are in a STEM program. You get that extra time to get a job or to apply for a job so that the company sponsors you for a job visa, right? Now, US, everything works on a lottery system. So you go and apply for a lottery, you apply for an H-1 lottery. And once you're done with that lottery is when, if you're selected in that lottery, is when you get an H-1 visa where you can go ahead and work over there. If you don't get an H-1 visa, you get a chance to apply again. And then, you know, apply again in the next round. So every year, I think by February or once in February for master's programs and once in end of March, which is 31st to 1st April, 31st March to 1st April, there's another round of lottery that happens. So you can actually technically apply for both rounds. One, while you're in the second year, in the third semester, you apply. And once you're done with your master's, you can apply once again, right? So you have two chances to apply for this, STEM programs, right? There are a lot of STEM programs, that are available. If you're looking at business courses, you're looking at, you can look at NYU's Stern's Tech MBA. You can look at Cornell's Tech MBA. That could be something that you want to look at, in terms of programs, which are STEM programs and which are business courses also, right? Cool. So let's get back to the application checklist. Obviously, you need to have a completed application form. So basic stuff, name, email ID, phone number, graduation, undergrad marks and things like that. Some schools have essays. So what happens is some schools will have just SOP, which is a statement of purpose, which is typically a 700 to 800 word essay, I would call a 700 to 800 word document. It should be a one page document. Don't make it like 2-3 pages. Nobody has time to read so much. The idea is you have to make sure that you convey to them that why you want to apply to this course, why you are the best person for this course, and why you're choosing this school for this course. These are the three main things that you have to focus on in terms of your SOPs. Some schools have essays, but they have specific questions which you need to answer. That could be something, again, it's not in all schools. Some schools have it. Resume and CV, again, if you're applying to technical courses, you definitely need to focus on the technical aspect of it, which is what are the tools you've worked on, what is the kind of technology you've worked on, what are kind of projects and what are the kind of clients you've worked with and things like that. But that's also very important. You have to focus that on the CV. Two letters of recommendation. If you're working, get one from your professor, one from your somebody from your company, preferably a supervisor. And get one from your professor if you don't have too much. So if you have present experience, maybe you can get one from your professor and one from somebody you're working with. If you have more than 2, 3, or 4 years experience, maybe you can get both from your work place. Preferably people, at least one person who can you know, talk a little bit more about your technical skills. That could be something, you know, you can focus on in terms of the kind of letter of recommendation. Official transcripts, all colleges will provide this. So you just have to reach out to your particular college where you did your engineering or your graduation and make sure you get that transcript from there. Some colleges also ask for writing samples. So this is similar to an SOP, but more about, it doesn't really talk about what you, you know, why this course and why this. It more talks about why it got you here and why it got you interested to this particular course. Some colleges do have interviews. Most master's program don't, but some colleges do have interviews. So again, it depends on the, which academic program you're applying to. IELTS or TOEFL. If you're looking at any US schools, it has TOEFL. If you're looking at any, say, Australia, or if you're looking at UK, then it is IELTS. Most US schools also take both, either of these scores. See, it's more like a checklist for them, right? So you're looking at anywhere between 8 plus on, you know, or say 110 on TOEFL, right? That should be your range or what you should be focusing on in terms of IELTS and TOEFL. They just want to make sure that since these are all programs which are, you know, conveyed in English or taught, delivered in English, they want to make sure that you're proficient in this language. So these two tests, IELTS and TOEFL, actually test you on reading, listening, writing, and speaking, right? So this is what they test you on. So you just have to make sure you're proficient on that. And obviously your GRE score, right? I think we've talked more than enough on what is important or the importance of the GRE score, right? So make sure you focus on that aspect of it, right? So that's what the application checklist is, right? Then we look at what are the deadlines look at. So I've just pulled out again a quick list of top schools in US and the deadlines. So we are in July right now. Please do understand that we are almost in the end of July. I would say mid of July. Okay, today is 17th. So we have July, August, September, October. I would suggest any time by October, you should be done with your GRE by maximum so that you can apply to all these schools and look at all these deadlines. Average quant and verbal scores, so if you look at the you know, the total, it's anywhere around 320 plus for most of these schools, at least the top ones. Don't look at the average score or the listed score as a cutoff, right? It doesn't work like this in foreign schools. They will also want to make sure they look at your SOP. They will also look at your research papers, if any seminar that you have done, if any project that you have submitted, you know, they want to make sure they look at all these things. So all these things are also a very important part, and obviously your undergrad scores, right? So if you don't have great undergrad scores, the only thing you can fix right now is your GRE. Make sure that you get a very good GRE score that they don't even bother to look at your undergrads, right? So if you have backlogs or if you don't have a great GPA, just make sure that you focus on your GRE, you know, crack your GRE in terms of getting a very good score, say, you know, 325 plus at least, so that they don't really bother about your GPA and your, you know, your undergrads, right? So make sure that is the only thing that can fix a bad undergrad, right? So make sure you, you know, you look at that aspect. So like I said, we are in July right now. Make sure that you start preparing for people who have not prepared yet. All those who are preparing, make sure that you take tests, make sure you take help wherever required. If you are doing self-prep, make sure that you are doing it consistently. You are consistent throughout your preparation. I know, you know, if this is one big problem that I see from most of the students who are preparing for GRE, right? There is so much of material online. There is so much stuff available online. People just keep downloading PDFs, and, you know, they have like 1 terabyte of data and in a folder called GRE on their laptops, right? I'm sure all of you are smiling. Most of you have this folder already, right? So I know this happens, and what is most important is make sure you're consistent, you have a discipline throughout your preparation, right? And where, make sure that you take help where required. See, what if there's no problem in taking help, right? Look at the longer scheme of things, because if you feel that at any point in a shorter span of time you can get better at it, right, then it's obviously better to take help and make sure that you apply to a top school rather than just keep struggling and, you know, ending up with a lower score and then going back to the whole pain of preparing all over again, right? Do it once, do it right, give it your best shot. Even if you're retaking, then make sure that if you're retaking, then you're not looking at something which is, say, you are retaking with a 300 score. Make sure the next time you take, you're aiming for a 320 or at least a 315 plus, right? To make it slightly more decent in terms of the second attempt that you're doing, right? So make sure you plan your entire GRE preparation according to what exactly you're aspiring for. Cool. So next, let's get on to the next part, which is part of your application. What do admission committee actually look for, right? So how many of you over here are worried about their CGPS? Just raise your hand. Okay, I have quite a few people who are worried. Okay, for all of you who are worried, since we cannot do much about it because it's already done and dusted, please make sure you focus on your GRE score, because that's the only thing that can fix it, right? To show your academic potential. Now, I'll tell you how this whole GPA is calculated also, right? So what happens is, everywhere around the world, forget the world, look at India only, right? Now, India itself, you have Bangalore University, you have Gujarat University, you have, VIT is a different, then you have Kolkata and you have Delhi University. Everywhere, there's a different way of how they calculate their GPA. In fact, in schools in Bangalore itself, you will have someone which is following a 10-point GPA system, someone who is following a 4-point GPA system. Now, especially when you're applying to foreign schools, and look at now, we are looking at India now, look at the entire world, right? Maybe Chinese have a different way of doing it, maybe Australians have a different, or Europeans have a different way. Now, how they calculate their whole CGPA is, first of all, you submit your transcripts, right? Now, transcripts is something that they understand, and they would be able to gauge your academic potential through those transcripts. So they will be able to take care of that aspect. Some colleges, I'm just going to type the website name on the window. It's called wes.com. Some colleges do ask students to get their CGPA converted into the 4-point GPA system through WS.com. This is a cost. It will cost you around $50 to $60. I'm not sure of the exact price, but you have to upload your transcripts and your mark sheets, and they will convert it into a 4-point GPA system, and then they will give it to you. However, this is not necessary unless they ask for it. This is just FYI for your information. Just in case they ask for it, maybe you can just go through this website and get that information, right? Next is obviously internship and work experience. Who are the kind of recommendations? What are they recommending? What are they talking about to you? What are they talking about your academic skills? What are they talking about your learning curve? Very important, right? So these if you're applying to specific courses, like, you know, let me give you another same example, like cybersecurity, right? You want to make sure that you have enough experience, or you've done something to show your interest for that particular subject. Because see, it is very important that you are actually competing against so many people, right? Now, for example, in this webinar itself, we have like so many people, right? All of you are applying for your GRE. Applying for your master's, right? So there's so much competition. So somewhere you have to bring in that extra edge in you to show them that, look, I am interested in this particular thing because I've really done so and so things on that, right? There are a lot of online courses that you can explore, certifications that you can take even for online courses which are on these particular internships, or, you know, to show that you are good at it and you understand that. That could be something that you could apply. Third is diversity. Diversity is, more importantly, what is it that you bring to the table? How will you be an addition to the class, right? Diversity could be based on your interest levels, right? Like, for example, I had a student who was, he said he wanted to apply to the school because they have great different kind of clubs. And one of these clubs was they do Rubik's cubing, right? So there was a club on Rubik's cubing, and he himself won one of the, he used to take part in international contests in Rubik's cubing, right? So that is one diversity factor. So he said, I really wanted to apply to this college because I really feel I'm going to be part of the school, right? So that could be something that could bring in some diversity. Diversity could be based on anything, right? So you could look at that. And finally, the goal clarity aspect of it, they want to know why you're joining the school. Right, you cannot say, oh, I want to do an master's from the school because my mother want me to do it, or I want more money, or your college is located in the Silicon Valley and it has the best infrastructure and great faculty and blah blah blah. Do you think they don't know all this? right? So obviously there's no point telling them what they already know, right? You have to talk about why you want to join the course. So please avoid writing things like this great faculty, great infrastructure, right in the Silicon Valley and all that, because you know, obviously they know all this talk about something that you can bring into the table, how you can be a value add. All this will require some kind of research on their website, right? So just make sure that, you know, you do your research around that. So very, very important. These are the, you know, pretty much important points when it comes to the application aspect of it. So yeah, how do they look at academic potential? Your undergrad institute, obviously, if you're from IIMs or BITs or NITs, added advantage doesn't mean people from other schools don't get in. Obviously not. Everybody gets in. From all schools get in, because obviously other parts of their profiles are also highlighted. But yes, this will definitely give you an extra edge. A good GPA, a good GRE score, any research or any patent work. Remember that you're applying for a technical program, right? You're not so here they want to make sure that you have that inclination to do more, right? And since it's a master's, it's based on some bachelor's that you have done, so they expect you to come with some kind of base, right? So you cannot be completely blank. Like for example, when you're going from a 12th standard to engineering, obviously they're not expecting you to know anything about engineering, right? They're expecting you to train you on engineering. But when you do a master's, which itself means you have some kind of bachelor's or some kind of background on the kind of master's you want to do. So that will be very important. So any patent or any research work is very, very important. Internship and work experience, again, a very important pedigree of the kind of employer. If you've worked in a startup and you've done really complicated projects, or you've really done really good stuff, that could be something that could be highlighted. Bigger company is always better. One thing that works for people who have worked in bigger companies is that somewhere, you know, for the school, they feel that obviously the company who have hired them, since it's a big name and a big company, they have done their due diligence in terms of the kind of aptitude that this person comes with, right? So that could be one factor that can help people who are in bigger companies. However, if you
it's
are
12 hours.
However, if you're from a smaller company and if you've done really good work, that your roles and responsibilities can tell, right? So that could also be something that can be highlighted and be a very value add when you write your recipes, right? So make sure you can focus on that aspect of it. Third, I think I've already spoken about it, demographics. Say, for example, if you are from in some country in Africa and you have been an Olympic marathon runner, right? How many people from that country are actually applying for this program, right? So that obviously gives that person a diversity factor, right? Personal perspective, unique hobby, skills, like I mentioned about Rubik's cubing, right? So that could be something. And goal clarity. Now, what I want all of you to do is make sure that, you know, maybe, you know, you can have a look at this question, maybe you can write down these questions. I want you to think about it and make sure that you have answers to these questions. Very, very important, right? Where do you want to go, right? Why do you want to do a master's? What is your short-term goal? What is your mid-term goal? See, nobody's going to ask you, what are you going to do 10 years from now? But it is very important that you know what do you want to do after your master's. After you finish your master's, what do you want to do? So they want you to have that goal clarity. Master's is not going to answer all your queries in your life, right? So it's important that you understand and you look about it yourself and you have that clarity. Why do you want to go there? Why are you the best person to reach there? Why not, you know, your friend? Why not somebody else, right? So why should you be given an admit? So you also have to figure out, okay, what are the unique things about you that you can highlight? Why do you want to do an MS to get there, right? So say, for example, a lot of people will say, you know, I want to go to US and I want to work with, say, Google, right? Now, obviously, sitting here and applying to Google, the chance that I'll get a job is bleak, right? Obviously, H1, all those things. But say, for example, I do a master's from MIT and I do a master's in computer science from MIT. There is a very high chance that I will get into Google just absolutely after my master's, right? So obviously, why you want to go there now is the answer, you know, that answers your question. Why do you want to do a master's from this particular college to get there, right? That's also important. Why not some other college? Why this college? Which means, like I said, it's important you research on the school website and you understand what is there and what is not there. And why do you want to go there now? Why not 2 years later? Why didn't you go 2 years earlier or whatever it is, right? So why do you want to go there now? These questions are very important for you to answer when you're planning your master's journey. Like I said, the focus should be to make sure that you are clear on your goals, you're clear on why you want to do it now, right? Just don't go through the flow blindly that, okay, you know, let me first take my GRE based on my score. I will decide what I want to do, right? I would not say that's the best plan because like I said, since you are going to put in all the money, since you're going to pay off your loan, you have to be slightly more cautious about the kind of effort you need to put in to research on the schools you want to apply to. You can always reach out to Crackable. We can help you out with the research of schools. We have options to help you out with SOPs also. So you can reach out to us whenever you're ready and you're done with your GRE, right? So recommendations. So how many of you have already decided? Just raise your hand. How many of you have decided who is going to be your recommender? That's a very small number. I want all the rest. How about you guys? I think you should really focus on planning out who should be your recommender, because see what happens is when you write your SOP and you write good things about yourself, it's great. But when somebody else writes good things about yourself, it becomes even more important, right? So it's very important that you find your recommender. You have to make sure that you give them some time. I understand if you're working and, you know, taking a recommender from your direct manager might not be a great idea because it might, you know, affect your appraisals. But, you know, say, for example, you have a peer and you can confide in that person that's saying that, maybe you can get me a LOR, or if not from a current employer, if you've worked in some other company before, maybe you can take it from somebody or manager from the previous company. You can take one from your professor if you've not been too many years into work, if you've just been one or two. I'm sorry, guys. There was a... Can you guys hear me? Can you just raise your hand? Awesome. Thank you, guys. Sorry about that technical slag. Cool. So I was talking about recommenders, right? So just make sure they talk a little bit about what exactly, what kind of, you know, you talk a little bit about what you want them to talk about. Make sure you go through it. Don't write your recommendations yourself. It's important that, you know, your way of writing your SOP and your recommendation should not look the same. So just make sure you get it written by somebody else if your recommender is not good at articulation or if he's not ready to write or something like that. There are cases where I have seen where people say that, you know, just go and send me the content. I will just copy paste it, because the way recommendations work is the mail is sent to your professor or the person that is recommending you on their official ID. And they get an inform. They have to submit that form, and that's how it goes to the school, right? So it's important select the right recommender so that they can really help you in terms of putting in the best foot forward for you, right? So they write good things about you, and make sure that there is nothing contradictory in terms of the way you're writing. Say, for example, if you are talking about how you've always been, taking a lot of initiative and, you know, taking a lot of seminars and webinars, and, you know, you've been always on the top of things when it comes to learning new things and things like that. You don't want your recommender to write that, you know, one area of improvement should be, you know, he should focus a lot more on learning new things and things like that. Because the moment they say something like that, whatever you said goes waste, right? So you want to make sure that whatever they are saying is also in line with what you have spoken on and what you have spoken to them, right? Madhura, we are just almost wrapping up this final few slides, right? Cool. So finally, I just want to talk about the upcoming sessions. We have three more sessions as part of this online workshop. The whole session today was focusing on the entire master's journey. Tomorrow, we'll have a session by Matu Gupta. He is a 336 on his GRE. He's going to focus on an 8-week study plan to plan out your entire GRE preparation. We'll have another session on 19 July, same time at 11 o'clock on vocabulary to make sure that you understand how to, you know, best way to learn vocabulary. And then we'll have on 20th on hacks on quantitative comparison. So basically for quant, how to make sure that, you know, you get the best score in terms of the quant part also, right? So make sure you don't miss this 4-day workshop. It's a very important part for in terms of your GRE preparation. It's really going to help you. And, you know, we look forward. So there's also a GRE course. You can look at this coupon code, CRACKGRE50. There's a 50% off on our GRE course for people who are you know, not taking the course and attending this webinar. Maybe you can look at this option and see if it can help you in terms of your preparation. Okay, so let me just quickly take questions. Okay, I lost all the open questions. If you have any specific questions, can you just put it online on the chat window? Yes, the video of this webinar is recorded. So you guys will have access to it within a few hours, I think. How to convert percentage to GPA? Like I said, simple conversion, you can just go through Wikipedia, but if you really want to do like a proper conversion, you have to go to WS website. Yasin, the only thing you have to focus on, so see, if you already have backlogs, we really can't do much about it, but what you can do is focus on a good GRE score. I think that will really help you in terms of your application. It is not important to get LORs from people. So the question is it important to get LORs from people from higher posts? No, it's not. You can get it from your peers or your supervisors or somebody who's senior to you. Say, for example, you are an engineer and somebody who's a senior engineer. Maybe you can get somebody to help that also, right? LORs from professors can be taken. If you've just 1 year, yes, definitely you can get it from professors. So Akshay has a question that, should we ask for a scholarship? So I'll tell you how this whole thing works. First of all, asking, you know, a scholarship part will come only after you get an admit, right? Once you get an admit, you can write to them and you can write a proper email to them saying that I think I want to apply for a so-and-so scholarship. And these are the points which I think I think I'm a good fit for when it comes to these scholarships, right? Nothing will happen to you since you already have an admit. It's absolutely fine to ask for scholarships. Obviously, you have to write it in a very much more sophisticated way so that, you know, they will never take back your admit. So that I can assure, but obviously you have to write it with a point on saying that why you think you are the best guy to get that scholarship. That's very important, right? Surbhi, lower score on GRE with 4 years experience, you can definitely give it a shot, but not to top schools. You can go look at slightly lower ranking schools where you can apply with this particular score. It is possible. People have got admits. I've had one student who had a slightly lower GRE score and got an admit to Rutgers also. So I think it's possible, but you just have to make sure the other aspects of your profile are taken care of, right? I really don't have anything about forensic science right now, but I can definitely help you out, Anjali. You can just write to us and, you know, we will help you out with that. It is definitely, like I said, the timeline, a good timeline to take your GRE is somewhere by October. I think it's perfect time because 1 month you can focus on your essays, you can focus on your SOPs, right? On your SOPs. So you can figuring out your transcripts and recommendations and all that, you'll take at least 1 month. So it's important that, you know, preferably you should take it in October. Yes, if you apply with some experience, it will definitely be helpful because your 4 years of work experience in that relevant field will definitely help. What if we are nowhere in co-curricular activities, will it hamper the chances of it? So, Madhura, when it comes to co-curricular activities, the most important aspect is how is it, you know, connecting to your goal of getting an admit or whatever your specialization is. Like I said, if you don't have co-curricular activities, you cannot really create one, right? So don't bother about it. Focus on maybe taking some online courses, which is relevant to where you're applying to. Maybe that could be something that could, you know, help you, right? Somebody's asking me, is GRE preferred or GMAT preferred for Masters in Finance? In fact, Masters in Finance, both are accepted. If you're looking at in London Business School or LSE, both accept GMAT as well as GRE scores. Most top schools accept both GMAT and GRE scores. So I think you can look at that. Other question is, can you elaborate on point you mentioned about interview with Dean or something? Okay. So what happens, Hafiz, is some schools, again, not all schools, some schools have this point where before they give you an admit letter, they actually say, we want to do a quick interview with you, right? So, which is typically from somebody from the admissions team itself will interview you. So they have this quick interview with you and then, you know, they want to just make sure you're a good fit or not. And again, this is not common. This is only in few schools. Right now you're right doing something in Java and you're creating websites for people. At the same time, you want to do something in AI, right? So maybe your story could be that, see, going ahead, AI is the need of the day, right? Looking at chatbots and not, you know, the kind of things that are happening nowadays. You look at you know, Amazon's Alexa, or look at Google Assistant, right? So you're looking at transitioning your knowledge of technology to that level. So that's perfectly fine. You just have to make sure how you show that out. Any gaps in your graduation or any drops that you have taken, just be honest. Don't hide anything. Just tell why you took that. You know, it's perfectly fine to take a drop. People take you know, breaks, so it's perfectly fine. You just have to make sure you tell them why you took that drop. A lot of people take drops to prepare for IITs, or people, you know, prepare for some UPSC exams or something like that. It's best just to tell them why you took a drop and just be honest about it, right? So you just have to make sure you do that. If you're not working right now and but you filled it up with something technical and you've done some internship, don't worry, you can absolutely apply. You know, it should be good. You just have to make sure that you tell them that it was a decision that was taken with, you know, you did it on purpose because you wanted to focus on something, right? So it's perfectly fine. It's how you put it across to the admission team which makes it more important, right? Cool. So I think I have answered most of the questions. I look forward to see you all attending the session tomorrow too at 11 o'clock. Do make sure that, you know, if you have friends or colleagues who would benefit from this, you know, 4-day workshop, do let them know. It's going to be, you know, really exciting and really beneficial for all of you who are preparing. Looking forward to see you all tomorrow too. All the best, all of you. And, you know, make sure that you really focus on your GRE. And for any help, you can just write to inquiry. Let me just write down the email ID at crackverbal.com, right? So you can write to them with your specific query. We would love to help you out. If you're looking for anything related to GRE or MBMS applications, please reach out to us so that we can help you out. Yeah. Okay. Thank you so much. Goodbye, all of you. Thank you so much. I hope you found this session helpful. Thank you so much.